Good morning. I'm loud. I'm going to stand here and kill time while we switch out laptops. I don't dance much. So good morning, everybody. Wake up. Thank you for being here so early. It is my pleasure to be here way too early and had to get out of bed so that I can introduce people. As again, sponsors, there's a lot of them. Go steal swag, you know, social engineer as much as you can out of them, especially if it's fun and interesting. This morning's keynote is Director Jen Easterly of Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, AKA CISA. Long pause. Making sure everything gets set up. I wish I had more notes. No, Carl, you tell us a joke. I'm like, no. When not protecting the cybers, Director Easterly is enjoying rock music and puzzles. Rock music, for those of you younger people in the crowd, is things like Def Leppard, Metallica, lots of metal, but yeah. Yes, and we are ready. So please welcome to the stage, Director Easterly.
Nothing like starting out an early morning with some Katy Perry music, right? Tried to buy the actual song, but it was too expensive, so we got this. Thank you for coming on. It's really awesome to be here. I have been looking forward to this for weeks. Why? Because, well, first, Tiger. Who doesn't love tigers, right? But also because we at CISA share a common mission and vision with the Diana Initiative, and I bet all of you, which is the mission to build a more inclusive InfoSec community and a vision of diverse representation at all levels of our profession. And in keeping with the theme of this conference, it's really a collective call to action for all of us to take the initiative to advance diversity at all levels of our community, both professionally and personally. Whether that's neurodiversity, diversity of gender identity, of sexual preference, of race, of national origin, of age, of background and skill. I bet like me, many of you in this room have not always felt seen, not always felt like you've belonged. And we know it's really different to be included in the room and then to feel like you actually really belong there. And so I'm excited to work with all of you to create a community where people feel not only seen, but really feel like we belong. Now it may sound kind of strange as I stand up here as director of CISA, America's Cyber Defense Agency, but I have not always felt seen. I started out in a really different place. From the time that I was really young, I wanted to be in the Army. My Army colleagues. I wanted to be like my dad. He was a Vietnam veteran. He was my hero. I wanted to be an officer. I wanted to go to the nation's premier military academy, West Point. So I applied early. I got in early, but I made one huge mistake. Anybody guess what that is? Anyone? I never visited the school. You know what I'm talking about. So I arrived on a scorching hot day in July, and I was terribly ill-prepared. I was ill-prepared for the emotional stress of being cut off from communication with friends and family, the physical stress of training, the mental stress of not just going off to college, but going off to join the Army. And I was really poorly prepared for Otis. Otis wasn't his real name, but Otis was a senior cadet, and Otis did not like the fact that women who had just been included in the military academy about a decade earlier, he didn't like the fact that women were still there. And he made it his mission to get me to quit. And he used to come up with all kinds of creative and diabolical ways to make my life miserable. One of the things he liked to do is, as I was walking down the hallways of our barracks, he would stop me so he could scream at me. He would get about 4 or 5 inches from my face, and he'd put a big dip of chewing tobacco in his mouth. Yeah. And when he screamed at me, little flecks of chewing tobacco would get in my eyes, and they would burn and start tearing up, and he would say I was crying, and I was too weak to be at West Point. According to Otis, I did not belong at West Point or in the Army. He didn't see me as a fellow human being, and certainly not as a teammate. So raise your hand if you have not always felt seen. Yeah. And raise your hand if you remember a time when you really felt seen. Now raise your hand if you feel seen here today. Because you should. All of you should. That's why I'm here. I see all of you. And the cool thing is, we see each other. Now, I believe it is both a moral imperative and a national security imperative for us to work together to create communities where people feel seen, where they really feel like they belong. You know, and the data shows it. These are statistics from Better Up. Communities of high belonging are shown to produce a whopping 56% increase in job performance, a 50% reduction in turnover risk, and a 75% reduction in sick days. It's not only the right thing to do, it's the smart thing to do, because it makes us better at our mission. And I believe it's an obligation of all leaders and all teammates to work together to create communities where people can be their authentic self, where we feel respected by our teammates and empowered by our leaders, and we feel like we're making a difference and an impact every single day. And that's the culture we're building at CISA, and I'm really excited to tell you all about that. But first, let me tell you a little bit about how I started. Now, a little bit of a spoiler alert. I did actually make it past Otis. And I graduated from West Point. My first duty assignment was the 25th Infantry Division, Schofield Barracks, Hawaii, on the beautiful island of Oahu. Now, the 25th Infantry Division is what we call a light infantry division. And so soldiers generally maneuver on foot. And they have to go long distances for long periods of time. And so you gotta pack everything in your rucksack. And it's really important that you put your most important things in that rucksack. And so I wanted to use this rucksack today to talk to you about some of the really important things that have brought me to this point in my career, and perhaps get you thinking about what is in your rucksack or what you're gonna put in it as you continue your journey. And it might not be a rucksack, I get it. It might be a messenger pack or a fanny pack. Jamie has this kick-ass leg pack thing that she's been wearing that I really like. But you get my point, right? So I wanted to start off, one thing you'll see in this rucksack is I have a lot of books. I am a huge reader, and I believe in the power of reading. I think reading is the gateway to learning and exploring new worlds, you know, whether it's romance or history or biography or literature or politics or poetry. I really think reading is one of the things that we can do to make us more self-aware, more interesting, more empathetic, and really better communicators. So I want to start off with a book, one of my favorites. It's by New York Times columnist, Tom Friedman. Some of you might be familiar with him. It's called Thank You for Being Late, An Optimist's Guide to Thriving in the Age of Acceleration. And it's about what Friedman calls the machine, which is the world's gears and pulleys and how it's affected by multiple simultaneous accelerations in technology and climate change and globalization. And he starts out the book with what he calls a technical inflection point in the machine that's driving the machine. And it was in 2007, 15 years ago, just 15 years ago. So what happened in 2007? And maybe I can get some audience participation for this one. So, first of all, in January of that year, at the Moscone Center in San Francisco, Steve Jobs introduced the world to the first iPhone, yeah, sparking a revolution in communications technology that's literally changed the way we live. But you know, that wasn't the only thing that happened in 2007. In 2007, storage capacity for computing exploded with the emergence of Hadoop, making big data available widely. It was also the year that development began on an open source platform for writing and collaborating on software called GitHub. I heard it. It was the same year that a small microblogging platform called Twitter began to spin off and scale globally, following the footsteps of Facebook, which just a few months earlier had become available to everybody over the age of 13 with a valid email address. It was the year that the popular mobilization change site, change.org, was launched. It was the year that Google introduced Android. It was the year that Amazon released Kindle, that's what I'm talking about. It was the year that IBM began building a cognitive computer called Watson, which combined artificial intelligence and machine learning. And it was the year that Intel first introduced non-silicon material into microchips, which enabled the continued delivery of exponential growth in computing power as predicted by Gordon and Moore in 1965, exactly right, Moore's Law. Just think about that. That was just 15 years ago. The amazing innovations that came from the minds of some of our most imaginative entrepreneurs. Now, believe it or not, in 2007, I was completely oblivious to every single one of these innovations, including the iPhone. And that's because in 2007, I was in Baghdad, Iraq. It was the height of the violence, the height of the insurgency, the terrorist bomb-making networks causing devastating attacks against Iraqi civilians and our troops on the ground. I was a brand new Army Lieutenant Colonel. I was deployed from the National Security Agency, and my team and I were asked to stand up this high-technology platform. It was called Real-Time Regional Gateway, or RTRG. It was highly classified at the time. It's been since declassified. And essentially, what we were looking to do was to take all of the collection in theater and integrate it and correlate it and enrich it so we could illuminate the terrorist bomb-making networks, not in weeks or days, but in hours and minutes, and provide that information to the troops on the ground rapidly so they could disrupt those networks. Now, my team and I sat in a van in the middle of a base in Baghdad trying to code up that system. I like to think of it as extreme coding. And, you know, over a period of time, thank you for the laugh, but over the period of time, there were many, many small failures, but there was no failure of imagination. There was really a presence of it there. And after a while, we were able to get that system up and running, and it ultimately provided a capability for the troops on the ground that helped them remove thousands of insurgents from the battlefield and save lives. And for that effort, I was awarded a Bronze Star, which is one of the things that, frankly, I'm most proud of. And thank you. was is it was a huge epiphany for me, not just the power of technology and innovation, but it reinforced for me the importance of imagination. Imagination to be able to achieve things beyond our expectations. Now, Albert Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge. He said, knowledge is limited, but imagination embraces the entire world, stimulating progress, giving birth to evolution. He said, do not sacrifice your imagination on the altar of crude reality. You'll wind up believing in nothing and having worthless dreams. Worthless dreams, imagination. Who has time for dreaming? You know, we sometimes dismiss those of wild imagination as impractical dreamers who waste our time, but I believe it's those of wild imagination who've given us our most important inventions, who've given us light and flight and power and code, who've put a human in space, who've allowed us to communicate instantaneously with others around the globe. It's those of wild imagination that helped us solve our most complex, our most interesting, our most seemingly intractable problems. Imagination builds innovation, it brings resilience, it enables empathy, it makes us better leaders, it makes us better problem solvers and better puzzle solvers. Which brings me to the next item in my rucksack, which is the Rubik's Cube. Now, I like to say I grew up in a house of cards. My family were huge game players, card games, board games. I loved video games growing up, and I loved all sorts of puzzles. And at the age of 11, I became obsessed with the Rubik's Cube. Now, some of you may know that the Rubik's Cube was invented by Hungarian sculptor Erno Rubik in 1974, but it was not introduced to the world until 1980, when I was 11. And as I said, I became obsessed with solving it. And it took me a while, but you know, I finally got it. And much to the amusement of my parents, I would go around to the toy stores in the area when we would travel, and I would make a bet with the clerk or the toy store owner, hey, if I can solve that Rubik's Cube in less than 2 minutes, will you give me a free one? Okay, so you can go on YouTube today and probably see a two-year-old solving the Rubik's Cube with their toes in 18.7 seconds. I get that, but back then, in 1980, 2 minutes was a big deal, okay? Okay, it took Erno Rubik a full month to solve the cube, and he invented the darn thing. So, after a while, I was able to amass a nice little collection of Rubik's Cubes. But the big takeaway from that as a young kid was just, you know, the shock and surprise and the faces of these toy store owners and clerks as they saw this little girl in braids solving this really tough puzzle. And it was like defying the tyranny of their low expectations. And it just taught me the importance of setting boundless expectations for myself. And that if I could imagine something, you know, I could achieve it. Anything. So, you know, it was a great lesson learned as a little kid. Now, going back to New York, as I told you, it started out a bit rough. But I was able to make it through. You know, my time at West Point, my time in the Army, taught me a lot of important lessons, to include about leadership. And I think leadership is a really important element in the mission that we're trying to move forward here, to create a more inclusive information security, cybersecurity community. And you know, whether it's leading yourself, which is very important, leading a small team, or leading a large agency, you know, it's not rocket science, but it's hard. I think it comes down to a few really basic things. First, I think you have to lead by example. Don't ever expect anyone to do anything you wouldn't do yourself, and always look to model good behavior. You know, whether you're a senior person or a leader, or somebody who's revered in their field, people are always looking at you. What do you do? What do you say? How do you act? What's the tone that you set? And it's really important that leaders don't condemn or criticize or complain or gossip. Really, leaders have to be inspirational. And so I got this several years ago in one of my favorite cities, Miami. I loved it. I keep it on my desk in front of me, and it reminds me that my job as the leader of this agency, leader of CISA, is to create an inspirational and an aspirational culture where people can achieve things beyond their expectations. So secondly, I believe in what's called the platinum rule. Now we've all heard of the golden rule, right? Treat others as you want to be treated. Well, the platinum rule is treat others as they want to be treated. And it's really predicated on an acknowledgement that we are all different. We're all a product of different experiences, different backgrounds, and to get the most out of our teammates, we really have to get to know them at a human level. Got to know where they come from, what their experiences are, what their fears are, what their motivations are, what their aspirations are. And to me, it's really about being an active and good listener. It's about empathy, being willing to put yourself in the shoes of others and see things from their perspective. It's about emotional intelligence, which, you know, I think is much more important than IQ. I don't know about you. And I love this topic. And so I've got three great book recommendations for you. First is Daniel Goleman's classic, Emotional Intelligence, from 1995. I've also got a book by a good friend of mine, Roman Krznarek, called Empathy, Why It Matters, How to Get It, hugely important as well. And then finally, you know, in every talk that I give, I have to recommend a Brené Brown book because I love her and true love lasts forever. And so Daring Greatly is one of my favorites. And what this talks about as well is the power of vulnerability. And I really believe that as a leader, we have to allow ourselves to be vulnerable to create that trust. And I'll tell you, like, that's been a hard journey for me to show vulnerability. But I think if you're willing to do that, it creates so much power in creating trust in a relationship. Well, finally, you know, the Army has this somewhat cynical saying that false motivation is better than no motivation at all. And look, at the end of the day in the Army, and you know, I was in the Army for over 21 years, and I loved it. And because fundamentally the Army is about values, it's about loyalty and duty and respect and honor, integrity, moral courage, personal sacrifice. But a lot of times the Army is about being cold and wet and tired and hungry. And if you're an inspirational leader, you have the power to turn what can be a dismal and miserable experience into something that can be much more bearable with the power of positivity. I'm a big believer in positive thinking. And I love this saying, relentless positivity is a force multiplier. Because it's really helped me throughout my career. As a young lieutenant after West Point, I had to go to airborne school to learn how to jump out of airplanes. Anybody jumped out of airplanes? Well, I am deathly afraid of heights. So I really, every morning I just psych myself up and be super positive to get through airborne school. And then later on, when I was at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, I had to go to jump master school, which was learning how to put 60 soldiers out of an aircraft, flying 800 feet above the ground, going over 200 miles an hour. And so, being relentlessly positive, having that smile on the face when you have paratroopers coming at you who are scared to death of jumping out that door, relentless positivity can go a really long way. So I want you to get a little flavor for the experience because it's awesome. That's why I always carry my little Jumpmaster guide with me to remind me about relentless positivity. I also carry my senior parachutist wings, my little Jumpmaster. you know, I mean, this relentless positivity is so important. And the other thing I learned in the Army was the importance of culture. I want to talk a lot about culture as well. Now, culture, there's a really great famous saying about culture from management consultant. Loved it so much that I went out and I bought the book. It's called Influence is Your Superpower, and I really recommend this one as well. Now, there are a lot of really good things in this book, but the one thing that I like the most is what Dr. Chance calls the magic question. The magic question. It's just four words. Just four words. What would it take? What would it take? Now, Dr. Chance tells this great story about human rights pioneer and activist Gloria Steinem, who went to a village in Africa which had lost many of its young women to sex trafficking. And she went and she sat down with the women of the village, and she said to them, what would it take to prevent this from happening again? What do you think they said? Anyone? Yell it out. Any ideas? Those are all good answers. Say that again.
Destroy the market.
No, what they said was an electric fence. An electric fence. As it turned out, when the crops in the village got to a certain level, elephants would come in, they'd eat the crops, they'd trample the fields, and it would leave the village hungry and very vulnerable to exploitation. So she said, if I raise the money for this fence, will you put it up and will you tend to the fields? And they said they would. And so she did. She came back 2 years later, and the electric fence was up. The corn was bumper crop high, and no more women had been lost to sex trafficking. Yeah, right? I mean, what would it take? It's really powerful. It's powerful because, you know, it catalyzes imaginative thought. It brings people into the conversation. It acknowledges that we all have something to contribute to solve tough problems. And it turns a conversation that could be confrontational into something that's collaborative. It unites us collaboratively to solving some of our most difficult challenges. So, you know, what are our most difficult challenges as a information security, cybersecurity community? Well, you know, the world is increasingly digitized. The volume, variety, velocity of data is growing exponentially. We now live in a world of 7.9 billion people, 6.6 billion on cell phones, 4.9 billion on the internet, 4.6 billion active on social media. There are now over 35 billion devices connected to the internet, a number expected to grow to 75 billion by the year 2025. From the first website that went live this week in 1991, we now have 1.9 billion websites. And in just one internet minute, there are over 575,000 tweets, 2 million snaps, 2.1 million Facebook logins, 3.6 million YouTube videos watched, 5.9 million Google searches, and over 231 million emails sent. Every internet. And you know, that data and those capabilities have done some good. It's connected us together, it's helped us solve problems, but as we've attached more endpoints and platforms to the internet, we've also created more points of failure, more points of vulnerability, and we've increased the attack surface for malicious threat actors. So now there's a cyber attack roughly every 11 seconds. One in 10 of those 1.9 billion websites leads you to malware, and cybercrime damages are expected to cost the world $10.5 trillion by the year 2025. $10.5 trillion. That's the combined GDP of Germany, India, and the United Kingdom. And all of this data is now available to malicious threat actors for weaponization, for social engineering, for information manipulation, and for deep fakes. Just turn that volume.
Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency. I'm here to formally announce that when it comes to cybersecurity, mission accomplished. Given the cybersecurity community's collective efforts over the past year, our adversaries have seen the light and have given up. That includes criminal syndicates and foreign governments.
Okay,
it's
that
time
was not
to relax.
Me. Somebody inserted
we
that.
We have
there.
Solved the cyber thing once and for all.
So, as threats become more complex and more challenging, as threat actors become more and more sophisticated, ensuring that we have the right talent in our community to deal with these challenges is more and more and more important. We all know the statistics, right? Millions of unfilled cybersecurity jobs around the world, hundreds of thousands of unfilled jobs here. And given the demographics, we are not going to be able to fill those jobs unless we create a more diverse and inclusive community, right? So my question to you is not what would it take to fill those jobs? No, that's not enough. We have to be much more ambitious. My question to you is what would it take to create a truly inclusive and diverse cybersecurity community? Now, what would it take to incentivize those in this community, some who are burnt out, some who are fed up, some who are exhausted, to stay in this community and to thrive? Now, what would it take to get to 50% underrepresented people in our community by the year 2030? And really, ultimately, the question is, what would it take to ensure that everybody in our community feels a sense of belonging? You know, that's why we're all here, right? That's why it's so awesome to have organizations like the Diana Initiative. It's so important to create that community to deal with the biggest challenges around the world. Now, my own answer to those questions is culture. I believe it's incredibly important that we build cultures where people feel psychologically safe, where they can be their authentic self, where they feel respected by their teammates and valued by their leaders, and where they feel like they're making an impact every single day. Now, I have spent a lot of time over the past year engaged directly with my workforce to co-create a culture framework of core values and core principles. You can see them here and actually learn more about them on our website. I also love to carry around this bottle because it's got the core principles of CISA on it, and also because it's important to hydrate. So, seriously. So you can go to our website and learn more about it. But look, the themes of these core principles are trust, transparency, teamwork, collaboration, ownership, empowerment, innovation, inclusion, and a fundamental recognition that no asset is more important to any organization than our people. That's what we're building at CISA. It's a culture that recognizes the importance of not just welcoming diversity, but truly celebrating. Because as we know, diversity, whether it's neurodiversity, diversity of gender identity, of sexual preference, race, national origin, age, background, skills, all of that equals diversity of thought. And that makes us better problem solvers. It's why I'm proud that we're one of the first agencies to give our employees the option to hard code their their pronouns into their email address. It's a small but I think meaningful embrace of the importance of acceptance. It's a culture that recognizes the importance of flexibility, that some people can be just as effective working from home than having to commute to the office and sit at a desk somewhere. It's why we offer thousands of jobs that are remote work and telework. It's a culture that recognizes that pandemic fatigue and languishing and burnout are real things, especially for our community. It's why we've made 2022 the year of mental health and well-being, and why we're providing resources to our employees. I'm really proud that we provided all of our employees free access to Headspace, the mindfulness app. It's a culture that recognizes that we have to treat feedback as a gift. It's why we've implemented 360-degree feedback for everybody at CISA to disincentivize managing up and to incentivize good leadership and collaboration. It's also a culture that recognizes that we can't fear failure. We can't be paralyzed by that fear. We know we're going to fail. We know we're going to make mistakes, but we have to go into it with a growth mindset, with a mindset of continuously learning. It's why I was really psyched to appoint some great folks to the nation's first Cyber Safety Review Board, which was stood up earlier this year to examine events and incidents and make recommendations about how we can improve the process. They just put out their first report at the end of last month on the Log4Shell vulnerability in that process. If you haven't seen it, I recommend it to all of you. It's also a culture that recognizes that the foundation of any great relationship, whether it's a friendship or a marriage or a business deal, is trust. It's why last year at this time I was so super psyched to launch our Joint Cyber Defense Collaborative, also known as the JCDC. Right? Anything where I can get some rock and roll music in there. My Def Leppard shirt, right? Exactly. It's our cool new logo for the JCDC. This is going to live in perpetuity on YouTube. I have to remind myself of that. You know, and it's a culture, finally, that recognizes that we have to make every single day count. I have this tattoo. It's emblematic of a Japanese philosophy called ikigai. And it's the intersection of four things: do what you love, do what you're good at, do what the world needs, do what you can be rewarded for. And I often tell my friends, if you don't like what you do, if you're not happy, go find your happiness. Right? Which brings me to the last item in my rucksack, which is this. Watch. This watch, which belonged to my dad, who, as I said, was my hero. And he gave it to me on my 30th birthday. And it reminds me that life is short. Life is precious. You know, you only live once. But, if you do it right, once is enough. Each of you have power. Every one of you have power. You have the power of choice. You can choose to be happy or miserable. You can choose to listen. You can choose to make other people feel seen, feel like they belong. It's a lot of power. Every one of you, no matter who you are or what you do, has the power to make a positive impact on the world. Remember this guy? I love this. My favorite part's coming up. Remember that? It's Nathan Apodaca. Some of you will remember he brought some real joy during the dark days of the pandemic. He also put Fleetwood Mac back in the top 10, which I think is pretty cool as well. So, you know, as you think about the theme of this conference as you go on with the rest of the terrific activities throughout today and tomorrow. You know, thinking about what we can do to create a more inclusive community, what's holding us back, what we need to do to create the change that we want to see. We all need to take the initiative. It's the theme of this conference. And I think there are just some fundamental things we should think about doing. First of all, keep speaking up. Your voice really, really matters. Cheer each other on. Let people hear you roar. Second, keep showing up. Your presence in this room, whether it's physically or virtually, makes a real difference. Makes our community stronger. Third, keep supporting each other. Keep making sure that people feel seen, feel like they belong. It really matters. Fourth, keep growing our community. Be a mentor. Be a coach. Build and cultivate your network. Inspire that next generation of information security professionals. And fifth, keep asking, what would it take? What would it take? Every one of you is an inspiration. Every one of you has power. Every one of you can make a positive impact on this community and our world. So let them see you. Let them hear you. Let them hear all of us. Thanks very much. All right. I think we probably do not have time for questions. All right, good. Thanks again, everybody. It's wonderful to be here with all of you. I hope the rest of the conference is awesome.